Welcome, everyone. I'd like to introduce our first, well, and only speaker, Giacomo Corrucci. He will introduce his team. I'll just tell you what the title of this seminar is. I think it's one of the longer titles, which means it must be even more interesting. A neutron reflectometry approach to investigate factors regulating the substrate specificities of I plot 2, I'm not sure if that's Y or gamma, and C plot 2 gamma. Okay, Giacomo, please begin.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, Harry, for the introduction. And so we want to essentially use the neutron reflectometry, okay, to investigate the factors that can regulate the substrate specificity of that two enzymes here, okay? So I want to introduce very, very briefly what essentially an enzyme is, okay? So an enzyme is essentially like this, okay? Yeah, I mean, this is the ribbon representation of an enzyme, but in the molecular scale, an enzyme is a protein. A protein is essentially a chain of amino acids, okay? And the proteins have a lot of function. Some proteins are also enzymes. Okay. So now, let's see this image here. Okay. I mean, is enough to describe a protein? I mean, a protein is only a chain of amino acids. The answer is no. Okay. Because essentially, a protein must to be folded. Okay. So the chain essentially must be folded itself in order to create a proper structure, okay, in order to have a functional protein. So essentially the functional of the protein is correlated to the structure of the protein, okay? So now this is an unfolded protein, for example. So as we can see, there are some amino acids in this sequence, okay, that can interact each other, okay, with some, for example, covalent bonds, for example, the SS bond, or some weakly bonds, okay, the H bond, the hydrophobic interaction, okay. So essentially, now we have the folded protein. So now our protein is folded and so has a proper structure to be functional. I mean, this is a very complex process in general, and it's called the folding of a protein. Okay, so more or less, this is how the folding works. So to understand this, I want to take an example. Okay, the GFP, the green fluorescent protein, is a strange protein because it's come from this jellyfish here, and is a fluorescent protein. So essentially, if we put some UV light in the solution where the GFP is, essentially the solution can green fluorescent. Very, very particular. So, I mean, over the time, some scientists did some molecular engineering, okay, in this molecule here, okay, in this protein here, in order to have different colors of fluorescence. So, for example, this is an image of all these kind of proteins, fluorescent proteins. So, essentially, the folded protein is a functional protein, okay? So, for example, our GFP can fluorescent. So now, if we increase the temperature of the solution where the GFP is, now we can see that the GFP is essentially a chain of amino acids, a free chain of amino acids in solution. So essentially, there is no more structure, okay, on this protein here. And so the solution is not more fluorescent, okay? So now, what is an enzyme? An enzyme is a protein, okay, that's it, and is a biomachine. Why are so important? Let's take another example, okay? The carbonic anhydrase. Okay, so, I mean, in the living organism, in the tissue, the living cells produce a lot of carbon dioxide, okay, due to the cell respiration, essentially, okay? And this carbon dioxide can essentially interact with the water molecules in the liquid part of the blood, the plasma. And essentially, the carbon dioxide with the water can create as a product this compound here, okay, the carbonic acid. And this compound here is more soluble than the CO2, okay? Means that essentially, with this reaction, okay, we can transport more CO2 with the blood, because the aim is the transport of the CO2 from the tissue to the lung to be eliminated, okay? The CO2 must be eliminated. So essentially, we want to speed up this reaction, okay, in order to transport more and more CO2 from the tissue. And this is, for example, the carbon anhydrase. Okay, the carbon anhydrase can speed up the reaction 10 power by 7 times more. It's incredibly fast. But why is so fast? Essentially, because in the binding site of this enzyme here, okay, this is the enzyme, okay, this is the binding site of the enzyme. Essentially, the enzyme can take the CO2 and the water molecule in the right configuration, in the right orientation, in order to form the carbonic acid. Is more or less the function of this protein. Okay, and then this is the graph of the energy. So this is the energy of the reaction without the enzyme, and this is the energy of the reaction with the enzyme. So the energy required is less in general. Okay, so let's go on. So the phosphorylase, the enzymes that we want to study in this project here, okay? The phosphorylase is essentially an enzyme, okay, that can cleave a phospholipid. Okay, so a phosphorylase that is an enzyme that can cleave a phospholipid. So a phospholipid is essentially this type of molecule here, okay? Oh, sorry. So we have essentially a glycerol moiety here, okay? Then we have that in the first position, we have a first acyl chain that is called SN1 because is in the first position of the glycerol. In the second position, there is another acyl chain, okay, the SN2. In the third position, we have the phosphatidic acid that is, in this case, covalent bonded to this base here that is, in this case, the choline, okay? In this case, the molecule is the palmitoyl oleyl phosphatidyl choline, okay? The phospholipid has also this very nice characteristic because has essentially a polar head and the hydrophobic chains. So essentially can interact in one side with the water, polar molecule in general, and the other side with some hydrophobic molecules, okay? In general, the phospholipids can be divided in different classes, okay? Depending on the polar head. So we have, for example, the phosphatidyl choline, phosphatidyl inositol, etc. And for each class, there are a lot of species depending on essentially the type of the acyl chain. So shorter, longer acyl chains, this is the acyl chains, okay? Longer, shorter, different number of double bonds. Phospholipids are the main component of the cell membrane. The cell membrane, usually, in general, is like this, okay? It's a bilayer, essentially. So we have the polar head in the outside of this sandwich, okay? And the acyl chain that can interact each other, okay? In the inner of the bilayer. Okay, yeah, let's go on. So now, let's talk about the enzyme. So class species is about the phospholipids. And this classification here is about the enzymes. So the phospholipase, the enzyme that can cleave phospholipids. So we have different groups, essentially. We have, for example, the phospholipase type A, okay, that can cut here and here. And this type A can be divided in two different groups, the group one, essentially, that can cleave only the SN1 acyl chain, the group 2 only the SN2 acyl chain, okay? The phospholipase type C that can cleave essentially before the phosphatidic acid, and type D after the phosphatidic acid, okay? Okay, the type B essentially has both the function essentially, the PLA1 and PLA2 activity simultaneously. Okay, so the type B can cleave essentially here and here simultaneously. So okay, in this project we want to study the phospholipase type A, so the one that can cleave only here. In fact, the main reaction is that one. So we have the phospholipid, and then as the product of this reaction, we have the lyso phospholipid, so phospholipid without an acylcene, and then we have a free fatty acid. Okay. Okay. Perfect. So now, the phospholipase type A can be divided in three different groups. Okay. Okay. So we have the cytosolic phospholipase type A, the CPLA, that essentially are in the cytoplasm of the cell. Okay. And then we have the calcium independent phospholipase type A, okay, phospholipase type A, that are the IPLA that mainly are in the mitochondria of the cell. Okay. And then we have the secretory phospholipase type A, the SPLA, that are mainly outside the cells. Okay. Okay, so now let's go on. So why are so important? I mean, the phospholipase can be found also in, for example, the snake and bee venom, okay? Why? Essentially, the venom, for example, of the snake can create a sort of tissue necrosis, okay? Because essentially the phospholipase can destroy the cell membrane, so essentially the necrosis of the tissue. So for example, for the pre-digest of the prey is important. The second thing is about, because I mean, a lot of phospholipase can release the arachidonic acid, okay? Arachidonic acid is the main hormone for the inflammatory and anti-inflammatory pathway. So it's very, very important. And the third thing that we want to study in this project is the influences that the phospholipase can do in the membrane fluidity. Why the membrane fluidity is important? I mean, why the membrane must be fluid? Essentially for the normal life of the cell, because the cell essentially have to exchange molecules from outside to inside or vice versa. And then it's also important for the replication, because the membrane must be fluid enough in order to have the division of the cell. Okay. Okay, perfect. So, for example, if we put the E. coli cells, okay, at 37 degrees and at 22 degrees, and if we can do some lipidomics of these cells here, we can see essentially that the ratio between the phospholipids that are in the cell membrane of these cells, okay, at two different temperatures, are different, okay? Why? Essentially because at 22 degrees, the motion between the phospholipids, okay, is less. And essentially, E. coli must to adjust the composition of its cell membrane in order to have the same identical fluidity of the cells at 37 degrees. So essentially, what we can see here, we can see that the phospholipids has shorter chain length and more double bonds, in order to create some disorder in the cell membrane to mimic the same the same fluidity of the cells at 37 degrees. This is very important and is called the phospholipid homeostasis. Okay. Okay, let's go on. So we want to study this project two particular phospholipase, human phospholipase. So we have the cytosolic phospholipase type A group 2. Isoform gamma, and the other one is the calcium independent phospholipase type A group 2 isoform gamma. Okay, group 2 means that can cleave only the SN2 position. Okay, so this is the cytoplasmatic phospholipase, this is the calcium independent, so inside the mitochondria. Okay, so now essentially both are involved in the phospholipid homeostasis. Okay. But for example, the first one is implicated also in the inflammatory pathway, okay? In fact, can release the arachidonic acid. And then the other one maybe plays a key role in also in neurodegenerative disease. So it's two important, very important phospholipase, phosphate, okay? For both, there is no crystal structure, okay? And the catalytic mechanism is not yet completely understood for both, okay? The characteristics are more or less the same, except for the calcium, because the first one needs the calcium to do the catalytical reaction, okay? And the other one, no. So, okay, let's go on. So, okay, there is no crystal structure, okay? So I did essentially an homology modeling just to see more or less a predict structure, essentially, okay? So I took the primary sequence, so the amino acid sequences of the IPLA2-gamma, the human IPLA2-gamma, and I did essentially a protein blast in the PDB database, the protein data bank database, where there are essentially all the crystallographic structure. So I found essentially that that the most identical sequence is of an IPLA2-gamma from this cute guy here, okay? From the Chrysaetulus. So the 27% of identity of this of the IPLA2-gamma is from the Chrysaetulus. So I took the structure, okay, of IPLA2-gamma of Chrysaetulus. I did some trading of, and some fitting, okay, of this sequence here, the human sequence, inside this structure here. So I did some refinement, and this is more or less the final structure, the predict final structure, okay? I did the same thing, okay, yeah, this is the Ramachandran plot, just to see if the amino acids are more or less inside the ERAS, okay? Okay, then I did the same thing with the CPLA2-gamma, okay? So the interesting thing is that one, because only the calcium-independent phospholipase has essentially this type of strange structure here called anchoring repeats, okay? Seems that this structure here is important for binding polar head of phospholipids, okay? But we don't know, because the same structure essentially is not present here. So we don't know yet to study it, okay? And okay, let's go on. Okay, this is a very important thing, because these two are factors that essentially can influence the substrate specificity of the phospholipase type 1, type A in general, okay? So essentially are two, the efflux of the phospholipids, the molecule of phospholipids from the bilayer, and the second factor is the active site accommodation, okay? So let's see. So essentially we have the enzyme, okay, that act like a probe, okay, on the surface of the membrane, okay? And then essentially the enzyme can bind a polar head, I mean the preferred polar head of phospholipid, okay? And then the enzyme can pick up the phospholipid from the bilayer. So essentially this is called the efflux, okay? Because essentially the enzyme can efflux the phospholipid from the bilayer, okay? So the efflux. And then there is this part here, that is this active site accommodation, okay? So the phospholipid must fit more or less perfectly the active site, the binding site of the enzyme, okay? So the efflux and then the active site accommodation. And then the enzyme can cleave the acyl chain, the proper acyl chain. So essentially, more or less, this is the principle, okay? So faster efflux means that we have shorter chain length and more double bonds on the acyl chains, okay? Because shorter acyl chains means that we have less interaction, less van der Waals interaction between the lateral acyl chains, okay? And then we have more double bonds, means that essentially we have more disorder on the bilayer, so essentially the flux is easier. Slower, the opposite, so longer and less double bond. So I mean, the phospholipase essentially prefer the phospholipids that can efflux easier from the bilayer, okay? This is the case, okay? Or maybe prefer the phospholipid that can fit perfectly the active site of the enzyme, the binding site of the enzyme. So yeah, we want to study it, okay, about these two enzymes, okay? And so we want to essentially synthesize some phospholipid that has long, short chain length and more or less double bonds, okay? So let's go on. So yeah, this is more or less the goal. The plan is the expression of the two enzymes, the synthesis of the phospholipids, Newton reflectometry, okay, to study the catalytic mechanism, okay, and other physicochemical characterization. Okay, so now, it's quite impossible to extract enough enzyme in order to do some lab experiments, okay, from the human tissue. So essentially we want to express it. We want to express IPL2 gamma in different type of cells. IPL2 gamma is a strange protein because it has some post-translational modification, okay? More in detail are a lot of glycosylation sites, essentially, in the primary sequence. So essentially, we want to use the insect cells for that reason. Okay, so this is the vector that we used, okay? This is the PFASTback vector, okay? Then this is the coding sequence that codify for the IPL2 gamma, okay? And there are some tags, okay? In this case are strep tag in the C-terminal of the protein. And so essentially are important for the purification after the expression. So we use this vector here to transform some E. coli competent cells. In this case, the strain is the DS10 BAC. Why BAC? Because essentially inside these cells, there is this genome here called BACNID. That is the viral genome for the baculovirus, okay? Baculovirus. So essentially something strange happens in these cells here, because as we can see, we have a mechanism called recombination, okay? So essentially the recombination means that this part of the vector, where is also our coding sequence for IPLA2 gamma, can exchange with this small part of the BACNID in order to have the recombinant BACNID. Recombinant because means that it is a product of the recombination, okay? So the recombinant BACNID. Not all the cells has the recombinant BACNID, okay? So essentially we have to do the white-blue screening, and only the white colonies has inside, okay, E. coli with the recombinant BACNID. So essentially we extract the recombinant BACNID from these white colonies here, this white, okay? And then we use it to transfect SF9 cells, insect cells. And so after some cycle of etc., we did some viral titer. Okay, so this is the result, the white blue screening. In this case, we have only three colonies, white colonies, okay, very few. And then we extract the BACNID, we did the transfection in the SF9 cells, and this is the fluorescent microscopy. So essentially only the green cells, okay, here, as inside the BACNID. So maybe are expressing our protein. The red cells are not infected at all. So now, all these are in the minus 20 waiting for the analysis. And okay, let's go on. And this is the protein expression about the CPLA2 gamma. The protein has no post-translational modification. So essentially we use E. coli, that is more simple in general. So this is the vector, okay? So we have the coding sequence of the enzyme here. And we have in this case that in the N-terminal, the 6 histidine, so is a histidine tag, okay? Okay, so we use this vector here to transform some E. coli cells, top 10, in order to amplify the vector. And then we did the purification. in order to have a big stock of the same vector, okay? So now we use we used a small aliquot of this stock to transform other cells, okay? The VL21DE3. These cells are proper engineered essentially for the expression of recombinant proteins. Okay, so essentially, after a very small growth, we did the induction. So we add in the medium solution some IPTG, that is the molecule that can induct, essentially, the expression of our protein. So after after the grow, we used the sonicator, okay? That is a probe that essentially creates some ultrasound waves in the solution. And then the cells essentially break, and all the cell debris and cytoplasm now is in the solution. So is in the solution also, hopefully, our protein, okay? That is like this, okay? So we have the CTLA2 gamma. Then this protein here is covalent bonded to the yeast tag, okay? The yeast tag is the 6-histidine, okay? Like this, can bind essentially a nickel ion that is inside this blue region here, okay? So essentially, only our protein, all in theory, essentially, can remain inside this blue region here, okay? So essentially, we can elute the pure CPLA2 gamma. Okay, so now I did some, before the lockdown, some expression test just to see if our protein is expressed. And yeah, I mean, there is the expression is very, very low. And yeah, we don't know why. This is the pre-induction, so before adding IPTG, and this is after induction, okay? Yeah, there is something, but it's very, 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 very low expression, okay? So this is the solubility test. I did some Western blot, okay? Just to see where the expressed protein goes during the expression, okay? So essentially, we can see here that 25 degrees and 37 degrees, mostly of the expressed protein goes into the bilayer, okay? And the rest part is in the cytoplasm. Okay, the best solution maybe is the 16 degrees where we have 50-50, okay? So 50% in the bilayer and the other part in the cytoplasm. We have also a lot of degradation, and we want to understand why it is degradation here. And before the lockdown, we did also some activity test, okay, just to see if there is any phospholipase activity in the wall cell extract, okay, before induction and after induction, if there is any difference, okay. So essentially, we took the wall cell extract, after the sonicator, okay, the sonication. And then we incubate all this part with some lipids just to see if there is some free fatty acid formation. This is the TLC, okay? And we can see here that there is some fatty acid formation also before induction. I mean, this is probably some endogenous phospholipase that are also in E. coli cells, okay? And I mean, in the other part here, before induction, the band is more in bold, okay? So essentially we have more fatty acid release, okay? I mean, probably there is something expressed, okay, that is functional, but with this test now we cannot conclude anything, okay, more or less. So we have to purify it and we have to do some other tests, okay? Okay, so now very briefly, the chemical enzymatic synthesis of partially deuterated phospholipids, okay? Why this? Because we want to use the neutron reflectometry, okay? So essentially, we want to use partially deuterated phospholipids. So we have, for example, we start with the phosphatidylcholine, hydrogenated phosphatidylcholine, okay? And after a reaction with a phospholipase type 1 from the market, okay, we have this, so we have the lyso PC and the free fatty acid. So after a separation with the SPSC, okay, we have the lyso PC, and then we can mix a deuterated fatty acid with a coupling agent, okay? So now the fatty acid is reactive, okay? And can react with essentially a free OH in the polar head in SN1 position. So now we have the final phospholipid, okay? And we want to use this kind of phospholipid to do some bilayers, okay, to study with reflectometry. Okay, so yeah, this is more or less the reflectometry instrument. So essentially, neutrons pass through some choppers, two choppers, okay, in top mode. This is the sample. So we have the silica support here. This is a bilayer. And so we want to add essentially the protein here in the bulk solution to see what is happening in the bilayer. Okay, so these, for example, some cures that we can extract from a neutron experiment. And after some fitting, we can see that we can extract essentially the SLD profile along the zeta axis of the sample. Okay, so essentially, we can see the variation of SLD along this axis here. Okay, so essentially, you want to see with this technique the thickness variation of the bilayer, the SLD variation eventually, if there is some loss of material, okay, if there is some bulk micelle formation, other, and if it's possible, the position of the protein in the bilayer, and also if it is possible, the orientation of the protein. Okay, so yeah. Conclusion, so we did the protein expression, we have to purify it, etc. We have to do some enzymatic assay, some neutron reflectometry. We have some bean time for that, okay? And yeah, I want to do some other physicochemical characterization, okay? Some substance experiment as well. And then, I mean, it is important to understand the dynamic of the reaction of these two enzymes, because on the future, maybe, we can essentially design an inhibitor, a molecule that can block essentially the activity of this enzyme, okay? Because one is relating the inflammatory disease, etc. The other one is in neurodegenerative disease, so are two important enzymes, okay? So yeah, so thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Giacomo. And yes, please continue the sharing of your screen. Now we will move to questions. Let me just remind you that some chat messages have been sent to you from Francesca, one of the PhD representatives. There are two forms that you can fill out. If you're a ILL PhD student, you can declare your participation in this seminar. And if you're anyone that's participating, you can fill out an evaluation of Giacomo's presentation, which I think Giacomo has consented to. Okay, and I remind you, this is being recorded. Now, for the questions, what I think works the best in experience is that you use the chat to send a message saying, I have a question, Henry. And it's probably even best to send it to everyone. That way others can see that someone has asked the question first. It's also possible to click on a raise your hand, but that doesn't quite work as well as chat for me to notice. It doesn't preserve the chronology of who asked the question first. Okay, so I recommend chat for that. And if you don't want to appear in the recording, you can ask your question by chat as text. That's another option. Okay, so start asking your questions. I'm watching the chat icon. And in the meantime, I'd like to ask a question of my own, which is really simple. This presentation was outside of my area of expertise, but I'm wondering, Giacomo, have you had a chance to do any experiments with neutrons at the ILL so far, since you're a first-year student?
Not for my project, but yeah, for other projects, yes. I did beam time D16 and D17.
Okay.
But not for the phosphorylate based project.
Okay. And have you familiarity already with D17?
Yeah, I did some experiments, with Yuri Gerelli.
Okay. Perhaps this is just something that I forgot, but I thought that D17 was restricted to a horizontal scattering plane, meaning that the sample had, in reflectivity, had to be mounted with a surface that was vertical, and so you couldn't have a liquid film as a sample on D17, but you've listed it. So what is it that I don't understand?
No, yeah, I mean, this part, yeah, I mean, because the bilayer is in stacking with the silica support. So it doesn't matter if it's in vertical or in horizontal.
Okay, so it's not floating on a liquid layer.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, okay. There is some water here because our polar head, so are in interaction between some water molecules. But yeah, in general, it's in stacking.
And these samples are stable in air?
No, in water, because the cells are closed. So you have essentially the silica support, the bilayer, and all is closed in a chamber, essentially. And in this part here, there is water.
Okay, but if it's closed in a chamber, that means that the neutrons are going through the chamber walls during the experiment, the reflectivity experiment, is that right?
Yeah, the chamber is all closed. So the neutron pass through the material, the aluminum material, and then cannot interact with the aluminum, essentially. So you can see only the sample, the silica support and your sample.
Can I intervene?
Please.
Giovanna, the neutrons go through the silicon, not from the top side. So the silicon is not exposed to anything.
Okay.
And obviously, it's nearly transparent.
And how thick is the silicon substrate?
It's very thick, goes from 1 centimeter to 2 centimeters, depending on usage and so on. Yeah.
Okay, so you just have to avoid accidentally having a Bragg angle or something.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's far away. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. I guess I should have thought of that. Okay. Interesting. Okay. Thanks for intervening, Giovanna. Thank you, Fella. Please ask your question.
Hi, Giacomo. I had a question about your purification step, please. The one you showed was about the bacterial system or from the insect system?
That one, you mean?
Yes, you showed the gel after that, no?
Oh, yeah, sorry, our E. coli system, yeah.
This is what I was thinking. And then for the Western blot that you used for the solubility test, what's the molecular weight of your protein?
Sorry?
The molecular weight of your protein, do you know it?
Because I can hear you very, very bad. I don't know if my connection maybe.
Now do you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know the molecular weight of your protein?
Yeah, I know it's about 60 kg. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because at 37 degree, I don't know if it's an overexpression or just a non-purification band. Did you see it?
Where? You mean here before?
I mean, for example, for the fifth one, five.
I mean, are two different gels. So that why are not in the same height. So what do you mean exactly?
Okay, the one for 37 degree, the one on the right, the gel, is it the same one?
Yeah, it's the same protein. Yeah.
Okay, so you can see the thick band. It could be an overexpression, but I don't. Since your molecular weight is 60 kilodalton. Maybe it could be a protein. I don't know.
Yeah, that one. Yeah. But okay. We don't know why we have a lot of degradation, and mostly of the protein goes into the pellet essentially. So is in interaction with the membrane.
Yeah, or maybe it's folded.
Yeah,
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Sorry.
It's just for the, you want to do partially deuterated phospholipids?
Yeah, exactly.
And just, so you just deuterate one fatty acid. And if I understood well, you will mix it with your protein. And so to check if the protein like is removing it, but how do you know the protein will remove this exact or deuterated or hydrogenated one?
I mean, because the is changing eventually the SLD of the hydrophobic part of the bilayer. Okay, because the hydrogenated fatty acid has a different scattering length density respect to the hydrogenated fatty acid. So essentially, if the phospholipase can remove one or the other one, we can see in this graph here.
Okay. But it will, I mean, you will have different proteins, so it will remove for all the phospholipids. So it will be the same at each time, or it's like 50-50?
Yeah, I mean, the protein is only one. So it must be specific, for example, for the SN2 position.
Okay.
So in theory, what we think is that our protein can cleave only the SN2 acyl chain, so essentially remain inside it. And then we want to see also if this part here essentially goes in the bulk solution, so essentially leave the bilayer or remains inside.
Okay, so you will see directly, and it could also like check if it's really this one that is removed or 50-50. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any other ILL instruments that you would consider useful? I mean, neutron scattering instruments for your PhD work?
I mean, we have the beam time for Figaro, that is the other one that has the horizontal geometry.
Other than D17 in Figaro.
Yeah, exactly. And there may be some sounds we want to do also, so D22, D11, yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Okay.
Just to study some solution reaction, essentially. Mm.
Okay. Did you have neutron scattering experience before coming to the ILL?
I did for the neutron school, some EN13, yeah. But only the data analysis, essentially. I saw a little bit the instrument, but yeah, that's it. Because I used before the ESRF machines, so the SACS, essentially, during my master thesis. The IDO2 and the other one, the BN29.
Okay. Mm. Yes, please, Giovanna.
So this PhD is co-supervised by myself, but mainly by Krishna Bachu, who is really expert in all this biochemical part. I'm not so expert. So I had a curiosity on your Western blot that I'm not sure I know how it works, about page 23, because you said that somewhere you can see the protein going in the bilayer and somewhere else going in the cytoplasm. So how can you see that if it goes in the bilayer or the cytoplasm? But I repeat, I don't know well how it works. So maybe it's a very silly question.
Yeah, essentially you take the cells, okay? You broke all, you can break all the cells with the sonicator, okay? And then you can do a very high speed centrifuge, okay, in order to separate the membrane debris to the cytoplasm solution. So essentially, this part is the membrane, so is the pellet after the centrifugation, and that part is the upper phase, so the cytoplasm part.
Okay. Now I understand. Okay. And then somewhere else you mentioned protein blast. What is a protein blast?
The blast.
Blast.
Yeah, exactly. Blast essentially is similar essentially to Clustal W, is essentially a bioinformatic tool where you can compare different type of sequences, okay? So you do, for example, in ClustalW, you have as an input different type of sequences, and then the program can essentially compare each other in order to see what are essentially the parts that are in common of this sequence. It is seems like an evolutionary tool, okay? So you can see where the evolution essentially remained this sequence invariant, essentially, more or less. The BLAST is similar to the ClustalW, but you can input only one sequence, and essentially it can do a sort of ClustalW with all the sequences that it has in the PDB data bank, protein data bank database, where are a lot of sequences where the crystal structure is known, essentially. So you can compare your sequence, that in this case there is no crystal structure, with other sequences where the crystal structure is known. So essentially you can identify the structure, and then you can do the homology model.
Okay, so before I leave, I see that there is another question. I just wanted to make a comment, and I thank the question from Aline, because actually neutrons are a very elegant and a unique method. In this case, there is no other way of checking when you break this molecule, which part stays and which part goes away. It's only by deuterating part of it that you can understand if you are removing something from your system, because it will change your composition, your scattering length density, and there's no other way of doing it. So I think it's a very nice project with these phospholipases.
Okay, thank you, Giovanna. Yes, I think we have a question from Francesca.
Yes, sorry, just a curiosity about the homology modeling, because for what I see is just what you mean with 27% identity.
I mean that
the sequence is 27% the same.
Yeah, essentially, yes.
Okay. And then the question is like, in order that then it seems that there is a perfect opposition between the the human and the one from the other animal that I don't know. Mm-hmm. Do you think seriously that everything is so well matched, or do you think so that it's going to be a more difference than in order that it just is 27%? Do you think there are going to be other structures that are going to be more different?
Yeah, I mean, because essentially, if the identity is higher, means that more or less the structure must be the same, more or less. Because essentially the chemical physical properties of a sequence of amino acids, if it's the same, more or less, we can say that the structure, the final structure is more or less similar. So it's a sort of evolution, okay? So
I mean, I also suppose that it's the same role protein, one in human, one in animal. So probably the structure will be the same anyway. I totally agree, but do you expect a larger difference, or do you believe that what you obtain as a tertiary structure is reliable?
Yeah, we don't know. We
don't know. And I see that you are also planning to do some secondary structure analysis, such as FTIR and circularity prisma. And do you think that you can add those information with the structure that you have already?
Yeah, I think.
So far, it looks just alpha helix. So I don't know much more information you can obtain with the secondary structure information.
Yeah.
Just okay.
Yeah, exactly. Well, we can do also this because there is a tool called Tsui-Fasman algorithm, if I remember well, that essentially can predict where is an alpha helix or maybe a beta strand. Or
there is also another tool that is you can use the software PS. You can find it online, just two letter. PS, both to do the homology again, also for the prediction of the secondary structure. I don't know if that can be helpful for you.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I can search about it and I can learn PS. Okay, cool.
P like Padova.
Ooh, okay. Ah, I know it. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Sorry.
No, thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. I finished. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, that seems to be the end of the comments and questions, Giacomo. Yes. So, I'd like to thank you again. I'm asking for everyone to thank you.